So today I want to share something that I've cultivated over the years, how you can assess a person's emotional and mental state by looking at a person and looking at their eye movements, their facial expressions, their gestures, their body language, and their tone of voice. So, of course, we all know that the eyes are frequently referred to as the windows to the soul. We know that smiling activates vagal nerves, the branches of the vagal nerves, leading to relaxation and increased heart rate variability, which is a sign of good health. We know that singing, chanting influences also vagal activation and relaxes people. And of course, by looking at a person's body language and gestures, it's quite easy to assess their mood or their emotions. Recently, I have been watching some of the political dialogue and the debates, and actually wondering why we don't use technology to assess the mental and emotional well-being of our leaders. And you know, it's not that difficult if you are alert to how body language and facial expressions and eye movements and tone of voice and gestures reflect the mood and the mental and emotional health of a person. A baby can do that by just looking at its mother, listening to the tone of her voice, looking at her facial expressions and body language. A baby can do that. And now, of course, we also know that when people are angry, there's a different tone to their voice. When people are not stressed, the voice is calm. When people are falling in love, they start to whisper. When they become love, they go silent. So, tone of voice is a very interesting way to assess a person's emotions and to assess whether they are sad, whether they're in grief, angry, stressed, loving, affectionate, etc. But recently, there's also the availability of technology. So it's possible to correlate tone of voice with emotions and biological markers of well-being and even disorders. The tone of voice, characterized by parameters like fundamental frequency of the voice, so frequently referred to as FO, amplitude and duration, can reflect a person's emotional state and is influenced by physiological changes. For instance, when people are angry and fearful, or happy or sad, they have distinct acoustic profiles that can be measured and analyzed. So these recently there's research that the voice is a reliable indicator of emotional states, often more so than even facial expressions. The fundamental frequency and loudness of a voice are positively correlated with arousal levels, which can be linked to emotional states. Also, certain disorders such as autism spectrum disorder can affect a person's ability to recognize emotions from vocal cues, suggesting a connection between vocal emotion processing and neurological conditions. Emotional stress can manifest in the voice, causing symptoms like a strained or fatigued voice, which are indicators of underlying stress or anxiety. And these vocal changes can be used to assess emotional well-being and identify potential psychological disorders, highlighting the importance of voice analysis in psychological and clinical settings. And today, vocal biomarkers can be used to assess mental health. Vocal biomarkers are non-invasive and can be collected using consumer devices like smartphones. These biomarkers derived from acoustic and what are called prosodic features of speech can provide insights into mental health states. For example, a smartphone application can analyze speech patterns over time to detect early signs of depression or anxiety. Studies have shown significant correlations between vocal biomarker scores and established mental health assessments. You've probably heard of the correlation between prosody and cognitive changes. Voice prosody measures such as pitch, jitter, and shimmer have been linked to cognitive disorders like Alzheimer's disease. These measures can indicate changes in cognitive function by analyzing features like pitch, instability, and amplitude variations. Such analyses can provide insights into cognitive aging and help identify early signs of cognitive decline. Advanced speech analysis techniques, including something called MEL frequency or Kestrel coefficients, MFCCs, MEL frequency, Kestrel coefficients, and other analytic techniques, acoustic parameters, are used to identify correlations with health conditions. These methods can quantify changes in voice that reflect emotional and cognitive states, often offering potential for remote health monitoring and diagnosis. So, in real time, one can do non-invasive and continuous monitoring of vocal biomarkers. In real time, one can get feedback. Tools like mental fitness, vocal biomarker, provide immediate quantitative feedback on mental symptoms and severity of mental illness. And then there's all kinds of ways to look at vocal biomarkers that can be integrated into widely available technologies, making them accessible to everyone. So, and of course, we can correlate all this with traditional assessments like heart rate variability, whether a person is lying or telling the truth, or comfortable, or healthy, or not healthy, both physically and mentally. So, why am I sharing this with you? Well, in the coming months, as we see, lots of debates, political, not just in America, but across the world, I think the educated person should have the advantage, or at least be aware of the technologies that are now available to look at everything from eye movements to facial expressions to tone of voice to body language to gestures, correlate that with biological markers, and come to some kind of assessment as to whether a person who's in a leadership position can be trusted or not, whether they're emotionally stable or healthy, or even have cognitive decline or other possible illnesses and stresses which may interfere with their ability to function properly. So I know when I say things like this, I invite a lot of criticism, but it's okay. I'm just expressing my views, and trust is the number one currency of good leadership, and there are ways to find out whether you can trust a person or not, and much, much more. So let me know what you think. I know I'm taking a risk by proposing that we use these technologies to assess the physical, mental stability of our leaders, and also how much we can trust them or not. So much for today. I hope you don't mind my suggesting that we have to be trusting of others before we make decisions that affect all of us, particularly in the political sphere. Of course, if you trust yourself and you trust your own intuition, you trust your own body language and what it is telling you, if you have visceroceptive awareness and you cultivate these abilities, you will make good decisions, not only in choosing leaders, but in choosing friendships and much, much more. I'd love to hear what you think about this. I'd love your feedback.